And you flew to Mexico to shoot, I believe, was it your first video?
Yeah, my first video I did Slip and Slide, produced by Devontae Swing. And actually, Genuine did the backgrounds to that song. We flew to Cabo St. Lucas to do the video. And Suge flew out over 100 models and all of the artists from Death Row went. It was really nice.
Has this ever leaked? Have you ever seen it?
The video?
The video?
Oh, the video was released. It's on. Y'all go online, y'all check it out. It's on my YouTube page, Danny Boy TV Unplugged.
Oh, okay.
Or you can go see it at just put in Danny Boy Slip and Slide. And the song was released. He spent a lot of money on the video. And we stayed there for about 2 weeks filming.
Okay. When it was done, somebody stole your jewelry.
Yeah. You funny.
What happened with that?
So they had this scene where I was supposed to look like me and the girl had sex on the beach. So all of our clothes and stuff that we had on was just laying on the sand, and my jewelry and stuff was laying in the sand. And we went to film another part while they were getting that, some of those filming. And I didn't pay attention to get my stuff before I went to the next part of the shoot. Mm. And I came back, all my jewelry gone. All my jewelry, probably about $50,000 worth of jewelry, is just not there.
And what happened?
Suge went off. He's cussing motherfuckers out, and my two guys that went over there with me, he was more mad at them because he felt like they should have been watching. He felt like they should have had my back, Kurt Cobain and Troy, my homie Troy.
Was Tupac there?
Yes, he was.
What was Tupac doing?
Acting a clown, like he was clowning more than anybody. So it was Suge and Pac clowning on both of my homies. Because Pac said in the bathroom, when he went in the bathroom, he was like, you know, Danny Boy always got something to say when somebody else niggas be saying something or doing something. But now his niggas, you know, and Pop's like, we gonna fuck their ass up. And my guy Troy is in there with us, and he's basically instigating the fight to fight Troy, to jump on him. And Suge is finna beat Troy up, so they standing in front of Troy, and Troy probably weighed like 110 pounds. And they got him in the middle, and Suge standing there. Suge go, who got more muscles, me or Pop? What kind of fucking question is that? Who got more muscles, me or Pop? So he's looking at Pac talking shit, and he's scared to say something, and he's like, he ain't really say nothing. So Hammer is in there too, MC Hammer's in there. Hammer put on his gloves. He got on his short, thin, cut-off gloves, and he's sparring and boxing to the air. Boom, boom, he boxing to the air like, they finna jump on my two homies in the bathroom. And Pac said something else, and Pac was like, fuck that, Danny Boy got to take care of his own people. We got to take care of our people, and he got to take care of his own people. We ain't doing shit. You know, he's talking about shit, and I'm, as usual, I'm like, man, shut up. Da-da-da-da-da-da. We talking, we argued like brothers. And my boy Troy was standing there basically scared and shaking, and got tears in his eyes. And Suge was like, so what you gonna do? You gonna handle your people? Or you want us to handle it? And Troy looking at me, and Troy got tears in his eyes. Troy like, you handle it, D. He told me to handle it, so I stole on him. But when I punched him, I kind of like swung and pushed him. Mm. So Suge and them walked out the bathroom, and my boy Troy just crying, like, thank you, bro. He just crying and shit. So Suge was pretty upset, but they was just kind of doing what, you know, Suge was instigating. And it was always the things that they always did, you know, just joking and scaring somebody. Like, they wanted to have them kind of scared because his jewelry was missing, but Suge was pissed off for sure.
So you guys, how long did you guys stay after that?
So we stayed there, myself, Suge, Michelle, my daughter, mom, and David Kenner and Suge stayed there an extra week. And we were ready to go by this time. We just ready to go. We were running late to the airport as usual. By the time we get to the airport, they're about to cut the ground lights off. Suge give them some money. They cut the lights back on. We take off. We get so high. I'm smoking a blunt, Suge smoking a cigar, and we listening to the blues. And I asked the pilot if he would cut the heat on. And so the heat came on, and then, you know, we're up into the flight. We're going higher, and he's saying, you know, how high are we going? And you could see the trash can kind of like inside out, kind of like up and down. Like, you see the trash, you look at it, and we ain't tripping, and it hit a pocket, we ain't say nothing. And about 10 minutes after that, David Kenner, Suge's lawyers say, land this motherfucker, it's on fire. Land this motherfucker, he's like tripping out. And when I looked out the window, you could see just fire shooting out of the propeller. Just shooting out the propeller, and at this time, the plane was filling with smoke, and the plane was going down like that, falling hundreds of feet a minute, and we were almost like 20,000-30,000 some feet in the air, and we're just going down. I'm hollering and crying. I'm praying. My daughter, mom, passed out. Michelle A's crying, and I was sitting in the back, and Suge was sitting back there on the back row with me, and he had his arm around me. Now I went back there, and he put his arm around me. Put his foot up and he was smoking a cigar and he was like, God got a lot for us, man. You tripping. We straight. And I'm saying every scripture you can think of in the Bible that would save me. And you know, to prove, I guess, him being right, you know, God had us. I end up with a herniated disc. I lived through it. I end up with a herniated disc.
From the flight.
Well, I had a car accident after I got back to the States the next day. So 3 days later, I was in a bad car accident. And a couple of weeks went by, I couldn't walk. Had no feeling in my legs. So I was kind of like in a paralyzed position for about close to 60 days in the hospital, trying to gain my strength to walk and all those things and to get my nerves. I had a lot of nerve damage in my back. And a couple of days before my birthday, they let me go home.
From the plane falling or?
I mean, the plane, I think in between the plane jerking and him making the safe landing that he did. And then, like I said, I got back the day after we got back, I called myself and go straight to the studio. And I fell asleep coming off the Mulholland Drive mountain. And I woke up under a semi truck.
Oh, damn.
I woke up under a semi truck, so.
And you were in, how long were you in the hospital from that?
Well, that didn't send me to the hospital. I got right out and walked from that. I just had blood coming out in the middle of my face. And I didn't go to the hospital around that time. That was around that time, yeah. I didn't go to the hospital for a while. Like, you know what I mean? I felt myself hurting. I started trying to go get massages and things like that. And after trying to go to, we went to the Bahamas to record the Christmas on Death Row album. And I just lost all my feeling in my legs while I was there. I recorded that album, those songs. I recorded those songs laying down on the studio floor. And when I got back, I couldn't even make it back without going straight to the hospital.
Man.
And after getting back, I was in the hospital close to 60 days.
Damn, 60 days for your back? Wow. What was it like recording that Christmas album? You guys were, where did you say you guys were?
We were in the Bahamas.
The Bahamas. Who all was there? Everybody went? Snoop?
What? Nah,
everybody?
It was just, it was Kevin Lewis, one of the studio directors. A lot of musicians, sound guys, background singers, you know, not a lot of the other artists. You know what I mean? It may have been another set of artists that, you know, was up and coming. But most of the records that was done, like Snoop and them did their stuff, we went over there and started doing all of the mixing and the finishing up and the recording stuff. I recorded all my stuff there.
Oh, okay. At one point, you had mentioned that you had to wear a bulletproof vest a lot.
All the time.
What were some situations? I mean, for everything? Award shows and everything?
That was a part of my shirt.
Okay. Did everybody wear one?
Yes, sir.
I hear conflicting, like, some people say Tupac always wore one. Someone said he wore one every once in a while.
I mean, you know, let me not say, and maybe I should say every once in a while. It ain't like I got up in the morning to put my bulletproof vest on. But we kind of, you know, if we were going out in a big crowd or some concerts or things like that, most of the time we had on bulletproof vests.
So, okay. You had mentioned you guys had to fight to get out of a few clubs. Can you give me some examples?
Man, there's so many examples. I think we fought everywhere we went. It was a Death Row tour fight. Like, that was a part of the tour.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Because, you know, being the most infamous record label at that time, a lot of people, I think, wanted to test and see what Death Row was about. And Suge didn't have no homies that played. Like, all of his guys were straight from prison, straight out of 12 to 20 years that they had done. They loved the street life. He just kind of helped them to get out of the streets. But when it came to doing street stuff, those guys was ready. And it was at the drop of I don't remember going to a city where we didn't fight, or sometimes maybe fight is the wrong word, where they didn't beat the shit out of somebody. So fighting, I guess, is when people fight back, right?
Okay.
Wasn't a lot of that.
No.
It was, if it was, it was kind of bad for him.